So good to see you on this first Sunday after the Thanksgiving Day that we all celebrated in giving thanks unto our Lord, and the first Sunday of Advent, the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let's stand and let's begin our time of corporate worship by the quoting of God's Word, and you'll find that on your bulletin on the back side of it and or on the screen. Let's say it all together. Colossians chapter 2, verses 6 through 7. As ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith as ye have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. Colossians chapter 2, verses 6 through 7. Now you remain standing, clear those throats, and sing along with the ladies as they lead us in worship through singing.
Jesus, you remain forevermore.
we? I'm so grateful for a God who sticks around. Amen.
Yes.
Let's remain standing as Brother Clint. I'm going to ask Brother Clint if he'd come lead us in our opening prayer. Would you please, Brother Clint?
Yes.
Before I pray, I'd just like to ask all of you to remember to pray for our youngsters. This past Thanksgiving, I lost a co-worker through suicide. Mm-hmm. And it hit hard. It's a young lady I've known personally who I work very close with. She went to school with my kids. She's 2 years older than them, but she was a year ahead of them. And we don't know what our kids are going through. And sometimes they refuse to talk. I don't know what it is or why she did what she did. But I'd like you all to just remember her in prayer. Thank you. Gracious and loving Father, oh, what a privilege to be able to come before you in this fashion, knowing that you're the Almighty God who answered prayers.
Yes.
You're a God who forgives.
Thank you.
You're a healer.
Yes.
You're a great physician.
Yes.
Without you, we are nothing, oh Father. And through you we can, oh Lord, we can do anything.
Yes.
Lord, we thank you for your mercy, which are new each day.
Thank you,
yes.
We thank you for the blood that was shed on Calvary's cross, that yes, we afford this privilege that we can come before you.
Thank you.
Oh Lord God, have mercy upon your people.
Please.
Yes.
Remember them, oh Father.
Yes.
Lord, remember our youngsters.
Yes, Lord.
Oh God, we pray, oh God, that you draw them unto you. Help us to be an example unto them, O Father, that they will seek your face.
Yes.
Just by seeing the way we walk, O Father.
Yes.
So, Lord, we pray that our walk will be worthy of you.
Yes.
Father, I thank you this morning.
Thank you.
I thank you for my family.
Yes.
I thank you for my church family.
Yes.
I thank you, God, for all that you are.
Thank you.
And all that you have done for me, O Father.
Thank you.
Lord, I thank you for our pastor.
Thank you.
I thank you for this man of God, oh God, we can come. We can seek him for advice, oh Father, and he's always open to listen. So Lord, I pray, God, that you'll continue to bless him. Continue to lift him up, oh Father God. Continue to give him a word each day. Lord, as we go into this morning's service, oh Father, we pray, God, that you'll open our hearts and our eyes and our ears, oh Father, that we might hear that which you have for us this morning, oh Father. Lord, I thank you. I thank you. I thank you for this new day that you have blessed us with. I thank you, God, and I pray for this country. I pray for your people.
Yes.
I pray for your elected officials, oh Father, that they make decisions that they will seek your guidance, oh Father. Lord, I just thank you, Father. Thank you for your mercy, which are new each day, oh Father. So, Lord, we just ask, oh God, that you go with us as we go into this service, oh Father.
Yes, yes.
In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
God bless you. Thank you, Brother Clint. You may be seated. Brother Clint, what's the young lady's name?
Diane Hampton.
Diane Hampton. Please remember her. God bless you. If you're sitting there in your pew, you should have a bulletin. And I want you to take that bulletin out. I want to call your attention to several important things in it. You notice that it's a little extra long today. And that's because it is the first week and the first day of our week of prayer for the Lottie Moon Christmas Offering for International Missions. It's actually the week of prayer for International Missions, but it's also the time that we begin our offering emphasis for the Lottie Moon Christmas Offering. Now, what I want you to do right now is to make sure you have these two items and make sure you have a bulletin, all right? And it's got the inside printed like that.
And then you have what's called a Together We Transform Lives Through Prayer. This is your week of prayer guide. And then an offering envelope. If you don't have one of those, the ushers will get it to you right now. Raise your hand if you don't have one. The ushers did a good job before you came in. We appreciate that. Everybody getting it. So hold on to it. We're going to be looking at it as part of my message today. Now, after the morning worship service, we're going to have the hanging of the greens, and we need you to remain after the service. We're going to have some hot cocoa for you if you want some of that. Shouldn't take too long to help decorate the church. And we're going to put some greenery around the bases of the windows. There's going to be a manger scene. There's going to be the Christmas tree. And all of it is almost just put together already. We just got it put it in place, and it shouldn't take so too long if all of you stay. I'm going to make sure that Mrs. Rosemary, she stays and does her part. Sister Rosemary, it's so good to see you this morning. God bless you. And then we'll have a good time of worshiping or fellowshipping after the worship time. Next Sunday, you don't want to miss it. We're going to have Sister Kim Jeffrey with us. She's a missionary with the North American Mission Board, and she does some mission work right here in our area with Rising Oak Missions. She goes out in these apartment complexes and other places like that, and she gathers the children up, and she does one-on-one with them as well as some Bible school and vacation Bible school ministries with them. And you'll be delighted and encouraged and challenged with her presentation next Sunday, all part of our emphasis on going, praying, and giving to missions. Then right after that service, we'll have our church council, and lunch will be provided. Now, and you're going to see up on the bulletin or on the screen and in your bulletin something about a cake auction. Now, if it involves cake, I'm all for it. Amen?
Amen.
Now, this is going to be our cake, pie, cookie, auction, all the baked goodies, the desserts for our Lottie Moon Christmas offering auction. Now, because of the COVID and we're not getting together as much as we used to, we're not going to have it in the fellowship hall and have all the goodies out there and for you to bid on it. It's going to be a silent auction. And during my message, I'm going to invite Sister Lynn to come up here, and she's going to share a little bit more exactly what to do. So ladies and all you bakers, pay close attention to this, because it's very, it's not too complicated, but it has some requirements and guidelines that we have to stick to for it to be a success. Now, our Lottie Moon Christmas offering goal is $2,500. That's the Praise the Lord goal, and I hope that we'll make that. And usually this cake auction is the fun thing that really sets it off and gets us over that goal. 3 o'clock next Sunday, you're invited to be at the Robbins Piano Concert. What is it called when you play for somebody? Recital? Is that what it's going to be? Okay, recital. Couldn't think of my words. And Christopher's going to be a part of it. Chloe, are you?
All right.
We're training him to be our next pianist to get this piano playing here, all right? And that's going to be wonderful. That's so good to see you in the house of the Lord. Oh, our third quarter ministry reports budget will be after the December 12th service, and we'll be doing that when the silent auction closes now. You say closes? Yeah, pay attention to what Sister Lynn's going to say a little bit later on in my message at 10:45 a.m. on the 19th. You're going too fast for me, Gal. All right, okay. That's Sister Lynn. Amen. All right. Let's stand, turn to one another. Now listen, you've eaten all that turkey and all that ham and all that potato salad, and you're feeling like, oh, okay, but don't let it affect your time of worship and the smile on your face. So stand, turn to your neighbor, and just wave under those masks. Smile real big so we can see the twinkle in your eye. And welcome one another in the name of the Lord. God bless you. Let's remain standing. There shall be showers of blessing.
There shall be showers of blessing. This is the promise of love. There shall be seasons refreshing sent from the Savior above. Mercy drops round us are falling. shall be showers of blessing. Send them upon us, O Lord. Grant to us now a refreshing. Come and now honor thy word. Showers of blessing. Showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling. But for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing. Oh, that today they might fall. Now as to God we're confessing. Now as on Jesus we call. Showers of blessing. Showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling. But for the showers we plead.
Blessing and honor, glory and power, be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne in worship. You will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days. Blessing and honor, glory and power, be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne in worship. You will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Kingdom shall reign over all the earth. Sing unto the Ancient of Days. For none can compare to your matchless worth. Sing unto the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne in worship. You will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days, Ancient of Days, Ancient of Days. Make us one, Lord. Make us one.
Make us one, Lord. Make us one. Holy Spirit, make us one. Let your love flow so the
are one through the Holy Spirit, amen, through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We are one. Thank amen. You. You may be seated.
Amen. Thank you, Sisters Lynn, Vanessa, and Carla. As they are being seated, you may be also. And take your bulletin along with your Bible. Open them both and your Bible to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 28. And we'll also be looking at the book of Acts, chapter 1. Matthew chapter 28, book of Acts, chapter 1. And I want you to be thinking about these three words: praying, giving, going. Now, how many of you have heard that before? If you've been a member of this church for any while of time, you've heard these three words: pray, give, go. They are the three points of focus anytime we're doing anything for the Lord. We ought to be a praying people, amen? We ought to be a giving people, amen? And we ought to be a people on the go for all for Jesus Christ. Now, we get that not just because it's something that we thought up that is good, but because it is something that the Lord has given us. It is a mandate. It is a commission from Him. You'll notice on our order of worship on the bulletin that Victory Baptist Church has a mission statement. That mission is that Victory Baptist Church needs to understand that we exist to glorify and honor the Lord Jesus Christ. And you'll find that in Philippians chapter 2, verses 9 through 11, where it says that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord of lords and King of kings. And we do that by the fulfilling of the great commandment found in Matthew chapter 22, the great commandment: love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor like yourself. And then we also connect that to the Great Commission found in Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20, and that's what we're going to read in just a moment. And in doing all this, we hope and pray and give and go to fulfill our mission to what? Make, mark, mature, and minister to believers in the faith. That is, to make believers in the faith, to mark them by baptism, by their outward profession of faith, mature them through discipleship, and then to minister to them as Jesus ministers unto us in the power of the Holy Spirit and in the provision of the Holy Spirit. So that is our mission statement, what we're doing. And it is all based on what the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ has told us to do. Now, you're in Matthew chapter 28, and I want you to begin reading with me at verse 16. Then the 11 disciples, how many?
11.
That's more than one, right? How many of you graduated from the schools around here? All right, 11 is more than one. I want you to just note that. I'm trying to make it funny so it'll be in your memory for a while. Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee, into a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. Now, this takes place after the resurrection of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, when they find the tomb empty. And by the way, if you go over there today, you'll still find the tomb empty. Amen? It'll never be with the body of Jesus in it again. He's died once, and he was raised once and for all. And so he has appeared unto them, and then he's told them, I want you to meet me at a certain place, and that's what they're doing. And they went to see him, and verse 17 says, and when they saw him, they worshiped him, but some still doubted. That's understandable. There's still doubt today, but there are many that are still worshiping him today. And Jesus came and spake unto them, especially his disciples. And what is a disciple? It's a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. Are you a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ? Look up at me. Say amen or oh me.
Amen.
Amen. A follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. So he's got at least 12 disciples, does he not? Not just one, not just 11, but at least 12, and he's got millions more than that. And so he's speaking to everyone that's a follower of him, and this is what he says, "And Jesus came unto them," verse 18, "saying, all power is given to me in heaven and in earth." Now that word all means all. All power, that means all executive power, all executive authority, all the authority that he needs to reign and rule as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So we're speaking here, or the Almighty is speaking to us here. And so he has all authority both in heaven and in earth. Now this is important for you to understand, to be a disciple, a follower, a witness of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Because we live in a world today that think they have all authority, right? The government thinks they have all authority. Businesses think they have all authority. One culture, one race may think they have all authority. Your wife may even think she has all authority. Your husband may think he has all authority. No, there's not but one who has all authority. And what he says goes. And what he says we can do, we can do. And we're living in a culture today, brothers and sisters, dearly beloved, where we are being told as Christians as a whole that we have less and less authority to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now you think about it. Can you preach in the public schools? Can you preach in a public courtroom? Can you preach and share the gospel openly at your place of work? Can you share what God says about morality and immorality? Can you lift up the name of Jesus anywhere and everywhere that you go? And the world is becoming so antagonistic toward Christianity that we're saying, you know, we really don't have a place to practice our faith. We really don't have anything where that we could go except inside the four walls of our church. And then they want to even limit us in when we can meet. COVID is an example. Don't go meeting. Well, we can understand for a while that that's a good idea, but what about if they keep coming back and tell us, you can't meet, you can't meet, you can't meet? Well, who are we going to listen to? The Bible says, don't forsake the assembling of yourselves together, as the manner of some is. Now, who gives us the authority to do that? The one who has all authority. Now, I've been in a public school as a substitute teacher, and there was a time that I needed to witness to a little girl. And she was one of these little girls who were going in the direction and having problems that Brother Clint just told us about. And I could see it. And I squatted down next to her. She had all kinds of tattoos on her, and they were those kind that don't last too long. And she was doing all kinds of other things, self-destructive to her. And I just wanted to tell her about God. And she just looked and said, "You're not supposed to speak about God in school." I said, "Darling, God's done told me I can talk anywhere, anytime, to anybody, in any place about him. If it gets me in trouble, it'll get me in trouble. But I have the authority to speak to her anytime, anywhere, and you do too." And based on that, listen to what he says to us. He says, "Listen, all power, all authority is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen." So be it, is what that means. Now, we're to be about our Father's business. And it's just more than one of us. It's more than just 11 of us. It's more than just 12 of us. It's all of us in that spirit of unity that Lynn was helping us to sing about. And with that focus of togetherness, we can do more together than we can do just by ourselves. How many of you found that true?
Yes.
A guy was walking down the sidewalk and he saw his neighbor trying to get a refrigerator into the house. And he was on the other side of it, and that refrigerator was stuck like halfway in between. And the neighbor that was walking by said, "Hey, Bill, wait a minute, I'll give you a hand." So he got up there on the other end that was sticking outside the door, and he started pushing with all his effort and trying to get it through that door. And the other guy, he was inside the house on the other end, and he was using all the effort he had. That refrigerator wouldn't budge. And finally, the neighbor that had walked up to help wiped his brow and the sweat that was pouring from it and said, "I can't understand it. I'm giving it all my might to push this refrigerator in." And the neighbor on the other side says, "Push it in. I'm trying to get it out." Sometimes we're working against each other and it just doesn't work. But when they understood which direction they were going and the neighbor started trying to help him to get it out, it went easily after that. And that's the very thing that you and I can do as Christians, work together in unity for the cause of the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, "All authority has been given to me. Therefore, go into all the world." You ever heard somebody say, "They're not my kind"? Huh? You ever heard that? Leave them alone. That's not what Jesus said. Jesus said, "They're all my kind. All of them are created by me. All of them, whether rich or poor, white or black, young or old, male or female, I love them all, and I died for all the world. I shed my blood just as much for that person as I did for you. And I love them all." He says, "Therefore, go into all the world." Now, we're supporting a mission board known as the International Mission Board of the Southern Baptist Convention. That word Southern, it was Southern Baptist. Now it's become National Baptist. But we've got an International Mission Board. And we're Southern now, kind of like Western Flyer used to be, or Western Auto. It's not a location. It's a designation of a type of mission and a type of denomination and what we're about. And if you say Southern Baptist to somebody that knows something about Southern Baptist, and you're those people who believe the Bible and believe everybody ought to be saved, and as a result of getting saved, they ought to be baptized publicly, they ought to partake of the Lord's Supper, and they ought to sit up straight and walk a straight line and keep their heads up and tell others about Jesus, and you say, "Amen, that's me." And so we have international missions, and we're going to every nation trying to tell all people about Jesus. Now, open your bulletin, if you will, to the inside, where you have all those little statistics and things about Lottie Moon and the International Mission Board. This is the beginning of the week of prayer for international missions. But I want you to look right there in the middle, top middle, where it says pray for missions. The week of prayer again is November 28th through December 5th. But listen, if you miss one of those days or you feel like praying on December the 6th, go ahead and help yourself and catch up and pray anytime that you want to for missions. Now listen, why is one of the reasons we need to pray? Well, Jesus told us to go. And the statistics tell us that approximately every day, 155,000 people enter into eternity without the hope of Jesus Christ. Therefore, we are to pray, and you're invited to pray and join in this week of prayer for international missions, where Southern Baptists pray for our IMB, International Mission Board missionaries, their ministries, and the unreached people, and the places they serve. Now, you take this little prayer guide and look on the outside of it. Look at it. This is your prayer guide to help you pray through this week for international missions. We together can transform lives through prayer. This is your 2021 prayer guide. It's not something you need to go by just word for word. It is a guide. And you open it up on the inside flap, and there's a word from our mission board president, Paul Chitwood. And what he is saying in Revelation 7, verse 9, that John describes a multitude from every nation, from all tribes and people and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. And guess what? You are in that picture. But here's the question. Will your spouse be in that same picture, standing before the multitude, standing with the multitude before the Lord Jesus Christ? Will your neighbor, your co-workers, will your person that God introduces you to, will they be in that multitude? Will there be others around the world that you can't go to, but you can pray for and give to the missionaries that are already over there? Will they be there? You see, God wants all to be saved. And that's why we exist. Now, on day one, on the opposite page there, let me just read briefly what you'll be reading about each and every day and praying for. Churches connect with missionary tasks. Tim and Tina Louderback and Sean and Shelley Blackston are passionate about equipping and connecting churches with opportunities to serve in Central America and the Caribbean. Anybody have any relatives or any connections with the Caribbean? Yeah. We surely do, don't we? Do people in the Caribbean need Jesus?
Yes.
Just as much as people in the United States on the mainland do. Amen. Now, the Louderbacks serve, as well as the Blackstons, with the International Mission Board in Panama, and the Louderbacks lead the America's Connect program in Panama. Now, when you think about America's Connect, I think about the time I went down to Brazil for the first and only time, and I introduced myself as an American missionary. I'm from America. I'm here to tell you about Jesus. And I was wondering why they was looking at me so funny and a little bit indignant-like. Finally, I had one old boy kind of stand up to me and said, "You keep saying you're an American. I'm an American, too." And I didn't think about that. I said, "Yeah, I'm from North America. They're from South America. And now you got Central America. And there's a mission effort to connect these." And so America's Connect was established to provide entry-level ministry opportunities for Southern Baptist churches interested in strategically coming alongside International Mission Board. This is to help us. Panama was the pioneer country for America Connect, and in trips later extended to Guatemala, Costa Rica, Brazil, and churches may choose to make multiple trips and send teams to different countries. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could send a team to one of these countries? We can. We can put not only money in the plate for missions, not only can we send prayers up to heaven for missions, we can put feet to missions. We can actually go as missionaries. I'm not a full-time missionary. Did you just read what it said? For churches that want to go just temporary and connect with other International Mission Board missionaries and take a mission trip, maybe for 5 days, maybe for 7 or 8 days. And it doesn't just have to be in Guatemala, in these cities, but we need to connect, and we can connect with them. Sean said they have been personally encouraged by the teams, especially by churches that are taking their first international trip. I tell you what, when I took that trip to Brazil, I was changed forever. I preached about missions. I encouraged others to go. I've supported missionaries. But until you go yourself and talk to somebody in another country about Jesus, we've had the opportunity to do that not only in Brazil, but also in Romania. It's just something else. He says, our prayer is that churches will be the first among many who come to work alongside us, and that some would choose to build on their experience in Central America, Sean says. So missions do not end when the America's Connect trip ends, the Louderbacks say. They encourage churches to put what they learned on the mission field into practice when they return back to the United States of America. That is North America, all right? Now, in the bowl there is your prayer request. Pray. And then down in the bottom blue, pray for inroads for indigenous believers who are reaching the lost. Pray for churches who participated in America's Connect, that they will continue to pursue opportunities to serve. And pray the Lord will facilitate more church connections. Now that's day one. Day two features similar missionaries and their needs. Now, look on your bulletin insert on the inside. Here's the fast facts, bottom right. We have a total of almost 3,635 people, personnel, missionaries on the field. We're global partners with other mission organizations, numbering about 25. People groups and urban centers are engaged by the International Mission Board, 247. New believers from our last most up-to-date statistics, 144,322. Now that's a year. That number sound familiar? What did I just say by our statistics say are dying each day? Almost the same number. So those that we're leading to the Lord in a year, that same number is dying every day. That's why we need to tell people about Jesus and support missions and missionaries. Now, when they die without Jesus, they go to a place the Bible talks about hell. Hell is very real. And there's no second chance. We've got to get to them and tell them about Jesus. And you can read the rest of the statistics there. Now, do you see above the fast facts that says, let us advance God's kingdom together? And you see the little octagon shaped, like they connect? That's the motto, that's the logo for us to understand. We're trying to connect together. In that little octagon where it says 100%, this means that 100% of the money that you and I give through the Lottie Moon Christmas offering goes directly to our missionaries or their mission projects. There's no overhead. Why? Because we already have the missionaries out there. We've been doing this since the early, late 1800s, early 1900s. That's why when we say the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, we can say with some assurance and confidence that we already have in place those missionaries, those mission statements all over the world. And when you give to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering for international missions, you can be confident that every penny goes to the missionary. Now, who was Lottie Moon? You'll find that up in the top left-hand corner, okay? Lottie Moon was born, what, in 1840, and she died on December 24th, 1912. Now, she's born on the 12th of December. She dies on the 24th of December. What are we doing in those days? Celebrating Christmas. And you'll read about her life story that she went over there as a single girl to China in the early 1900s. And listen, I wouldn't go over by myself as a man today. I want somebody going with me. But she went over there and she made an impact on the Chinese. And she sacrificed so much, and she would write back saying, we need more missionaries. We need more money. And so she began to write these letters of appeal that went to churches. And the way they would do it back in those days, as some churches do today, missionaries would come off the field, and they would go to church to make an appeal for their missions. How many of you ever been in a church or a missionary? We have that here. We're going to have the sister that's coming next week to hear but she's a North American missionary, and she's going to share with us what we're doing through our North American Mission Board. Now, when a missionary comes off the field, what's happening? They're not on the field. They can't witness, can they? They have to come and make an appeal. And what would happen usually in churches, they would have one missionary in 1 week that would make an appeal, and they'd give a little bit. Then they'd have this dynamic missionary come in the next week, and they'd make an appeal, and he was so dynamic, or they were so dynamic, and they would just give a lot of money to them. I mean, just really move hearts. Where it wasn't necessarily that the work was more important than the previous missionaries, but it was just whoever's making the best appeal. But they were coming off the field. This is where Southern Baptists came up with what we call the Cooperative Program, CP. And you may have heard some preachers say, or some others in the church said, we need to give to the Cooperative Program. Let me change that preposition. We don't give to the Cooperative Program, we give through the Cooperative Program. Now, what is the Cooperative Program? Well, the Southern Baptist churches got together and said, listen, we can do more together than we can do as individuals. And that's when we established the home mission board, which is now the North American Mission Board, and the foreign mission board, which is now the International Mission Board. And we just decided, rather than pulling the missionaries in off the field all the time and letting them have to travel from church to church and make an appeal and some getting better offerings because they were better appealers, and they said, why don't we just contribute to the North American Mission Board and to the Foreign Mission Board or the International Mission Board, and we can all give and keep the missionaries on the field, and we'll give through the Cooperative Program, and from those program monies, we can support missionaries. And so rather than trying to support one missionary, look at it again, when we give in our offering plate here at Victory Baptist Church, part of that offering goes to support 3,635 international missionaries, not counting your North American missionaries, which we'll emphasize in the Easter season, not counting your state missionaries. How is that done, Mr. Cook? Well, you don't have to call me Mr. Call me brother, because I'm here to help you. I'm your pastor. Look at this giving to send missionaries diagram in the bottom left. Now, stay up with me here. This is very important, and it'll make so much sense to you, and it'll bless your heart when you understand it. Remember, we can do more together than alone. The Cooperative Program helps us to do that. We don't give to it, we give through it. Now, were that those words, giving churches, that would include us. Every time you give an offering in this church, part of that offering, as we have designated in our annual budget, goes to our state convention, the Georgia Baptist Convention. You'll see that on the top line, okay? You see the arrow going up to the top line? Now, that circle represents all the state conventions that are having local churches like us give to them part of their regular offerings through the Cooperative Program. Now, state conventions today, all of them, they give from 45% to 85% or stays in place, and then they give the other percent, do you see it, to the Southern Cooperative Baptist Convention Cooperative Program. Out of the Southern Baptist Cooperative Program, you see the arrow going down? 50% of that goes to the International Mission Board. The other 50% goes to support our other Southern Baptist Church entities, like the North American Mission Board, our seminaries, the Ethics and Religious Liberty Commission, and Executive Commission. All right, do you see where the money comes from to support the International Mission Board from the Cooperative Program? Now, that is only 37% of the total annual budget of the International Mission Board. Where does the other 61% or 63% come from? Well, the majority, 61% of it, do you see the bottom arrow coming down? It comes from the Lottie Moon Christmas Offering, which 100% of what you give through the Lottie Moon Christmas Offering goes to the International Mission Board. And how dependent is the International Mission Board on that? Well, it makes up 61% of their annual budget, right? So they're very dependent on that, and that's why it's so important. And so all these monies, whether it comes through the weekly giving of the churches through the Cooperative Program, or the one-time emphasis of the Lottie Moon Christmas Offering, all that goes to take the gospel to every language, tribe, and nation. How many of you understand a little bit more better about the Cooperative Program now? Raise your hand. Okay. If you don't, go back and study that. On that offering envelope where it says together, and you have the little QR code there, you can put your phone over that, and if your phone is able to interpret a QR code, it'll take you to the International Mission Board website, and you can just spend all day on that looking at all the things that our International Mission Board does. Now, we have a goal of how much? $2,500. The Southern Baptist Convention as a whole has a goal of $185 million. Now look up here. If you want the Southern Baptist Convention to go ahead and meet their goal just like that, write a check out for $185 million before you leave today. I don't know what y'all have in your bank account, but I'm pretty sure most of us can't come up even with half of that, all right? Not even a tenth of it. But here's what you can do. You can give toward our goal of $2,500 and give today using this envelope. You see that envelope? Everybody hold that envelope up for me. Everybody but Miss Rosemary's holding it up. I don't know. Everybody. I'm picking on her today. I love her to death. But you know how to use that envelope. Look on the back. Wait a minute. I see Chinese and all kinds of languages. Do you see English? Read that. And put your name on there. Put your amount. And then put your envelope number or the date. And everything that comes in that envelope, as you drop off the offering at the end of the service, will be given toward our Light of Moon Christmas offering goal of $2,500. Make sure you use that envelope so we'll get it. And there'll be more envelopes out there for later on in the month. Now, here's how Carl and I do it. We give a little bit. We're starting today. We want to give a little bit every week until we meet our goal. That helps me to remind myself we're giving and praying for the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. Also, giving a little bit each week helps on the budget, too. All right. Then we're going to have something coming up. You heard me say something about the cake auction. Well, Sister Lynn is coming up here, and those of you who are bakers and cookers, are bakers, right? I'm a cooker. I'm a cooker. Amen. She's going to tell you exactly how that goes. Listen very carefully. Thank you, Sister Lynn.
And let me just start right off, and most of you know it already, but this is for fun. It's to raise money for Lottie Moon Christmas offering. And it's just a fun way to do it. And we wish we could all join together in the fellowship hall like we used to and have our little time of bidding on the cakes and the pies. And they go high. Trust me, they will go high. But remember, we're doing it for Lottie Moon Christmas offering for no other reason than just that, for missions. So what we're going to do this year is a silent auction, and there's going to be, I would like for all of the ladies or whoever wants to bake, Mr. Guy, you want to bake? You don't want him to bake either. And so we're going to just let me know what you might like to offer to the Lottie Moon Christmas cake, cookies, pies to be auctioned off. And we're going to put it on a piece of paper and have it available for y'all to put your amount, what you might like to pay for it, in the next two Sundays, the 5th and the 12th, closing out at 10:45 on the 19th. It will not go any later than that. I will be pulling those sheets at 10:45. And trust me, I can pull those sheets at 10:45. So get your bids in the next couple of Sundays. Ladies, please let me know what you'd like to give. Most of the items are going to start at around about $25. I will tell you that right off. Now, the way that I do this, Guy and I do this, is that we already know how much we want to give to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. And so as James and Carla, they know what they're going to bid on their, what they would like to bid also, but they're giving weekly. Guy and I usually do it through the auction. We buy until it hurts. That's the way it is. So we just have fun with it, and that's what it is. It's just a fun time. I know Carla is going to be doing peanut butter bars. She's going to be doing fudge. I'm going to be doing pecan pies.
Pound cakes.
Joy's
doing friendship bread.
Yeah, Joy's going to be doing some friendship bread. So let me know what you'd like to offer up to the cake auction by the 3rd, so I can make the sheets up. They're going to be in the fellowship hall spread out. You go around, bring your own pen, write down the price that you want to pay, and they're going to be in $5 increments that you go up on each of the items. So I hope that makes sense. If not, come and ask me some questions, and I'll see if I can't explain it a little bit better to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
This is for fun.
Thank you so much, Sister Lynn. And it is a lot of fun, and it's even more fun when you know that that money is gone, every penny of it, to support missionaries and their efforts to win people to Jesus. How many people are dying every day without Jesus? 155,000 people. We need to make a difference. Now take your Bible. You've been in Matthew chapter 28. I want to close out by reading Acts chapter 1. And when we get to Acts chapter 1, let's just go on to go verse 6. Acts chapter 1, verse 6. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, the Lord Jesus, wilt thou at this time again restore the kingdom to Israel? Now they're talking about the kingdom of God. They got one kind of kingdom in their mind, and Jesus has an entirely different kind of kingdom in his mind. They're saying, you're going to restore us to our political, cultural, and geographical glory like we used to have under Solomon, and Jesus has an entirely different thing in mind, and therefore it has a different timetable. And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power. Remember, all authority has been given unto me, both in heaven and in earth. Go, therefore. This is what Jesus says. This is your focus, but you will receive power or authority after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me, both in where? Jerusalem and all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Closely, he says, you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea, and then outwardly in Samaria unto the uttermost parts of the world. That talks about local missions. That talks about state missions. That talks about national missions. And to the uttermost parts of the world talks about international missions, what we're emphasizing now. And when he had spoken these things, listen very carefully, while they beheld, he was what? Taken up, and the cloud received him out of their sight. Now, what if you were standing in that crowd and you witnessed that? You would probably be doing the same things that these old boys were doing, and they were called out for it. Listen, and when he had spoken these things, they beheld, he was taken up, and the cloud received him out of sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why are you standing here gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go into heaven. Therefore, listen to what he said in verse 8. You shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the world. We know Jesus has come down. We know that Jesus has walked around. We know that Jesus has ascended into heaven and he's coming back. No time to waste looking up into heaven, waiting for him to come back. We need to get busy knowing that he's coming back, and that when he does, it'll be too late for anyone to get saved. We need to be his witnesses, because if you've placed your faith and trust in him, the Bible says that you have received the power and the authority and the commission of the Holy Spirit to be his witnesses. And one of the ways that you can do that is tell somebody face to face, go across the street, and support your missionaries through your praying, through your giving, and then even going alongside them, as day one missionaries said that we could do if we partner up and come down to Central America and the Panamas and be a church that goes out into those local areas. Or you can simply give your money if you can't go and send your prayers ahead of them. We have a mission. And together, you and I can do more than we can do alone. As we pray together, as we give together, and as we go together. We went to the game yesterday. Kind of wish I didn't. Them old Georgia Bulldogs whipped up on us. But we got to meet with our two sons and their children, and it was a good time with the grandchildren. It was crowded when we were let off at the curb there in front of gate one. And once you step into that crowd on the sidewalk, you got to kind of move with them. And we were being pushed along as we tried to keep up with our party that was ahead of us. And there was a man standing on a wall that was about 2 or 3 feet tall, right at that busy park next to the stadium and the gates and people coming by, just hundreds of people. And he was preaching. It was street preacher. And I was reminded of my calling to be a preacher. And the crowd was going by fast. We were all kind of shoulder to shoulder. And I wanted to encourage him. And I walked up to him and I patted his feet. I said, "You have beautiful feet. How beautiful are the feet of those who publish the gospel of good news." Yeah. And by that time, I had moved on down. And I could hear him on the intercom. "Did y'all hear that? How about it? I've got beautiful feet." What was he talking about? And he went on to explain that. Well, I thought it was all over. I'd give him a little encouragement. But this old boy had been next to me. He was looking at him and said, "What was that about?" I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "I got ugly feet." I said, "I was telling him about," and we're trying to move at the same time, watch where we're going. I said, "I was trying to tell him about the gospel." He said he had ugly feet. I said, "But they're beautiful feet." And I tried to explain to him it was a metaphor. Because no matter how ugly your feet look, to the one who's needing to hear the good news, those feet become beautiful because you've brought the gospel to them. It's just like some of you who've been sick and you're sitting at home and a neighbor walks across the street with a pot of chicken soup. Last night, our neighbors brought us some, what's that pecan stuff? Oh, sweet potato souffle with a lot of pecans on it. It was in a pan about that big, full. There's about that much left for you. I left for you if you want. Then some kind of corn casserole. It was good. Now, that's my neighbor. He ain't as pretty as I am, but he was beautiful last night because he brought that food to me. Now, if we can get all excited about physical food, just think of the world out there that will get excited about hearing how that they can be saved. 155,000 a day dying, perishing without Jesus. They may have not thought that the gospel was good news, but now in hell, they would give everything they had to come back for another opportunity to give their life to Jesus. Now think about that old boy who's out on that wall at that busy street corner yesterday preaching the gospel and people just going by back and forth, not even thinking about it. But I know at least two people who thought about it. Me and that old boy that shouldered up to me and stayed with me until I could tell him about why feet are beautiful, because they bring the gospel of Jesus. And he seemed to just, out of nowhere, just listen to me. And then the crowd separated us. We've got missionaries out there that are willing to go and tell people about Jesus. And they're going in some dangerous places. They're out there in a foreign mission field in a time that our world is so fragile. But they've heard the call and they've gone. And like that street preacher, they're proclaiming, "Jesus saves! Jesus saves!" And some are getting saved. And they say, "Oh, how beautiful are your feet that have brought me the message all the way from the United States of America to where I am." They can say, "Brother, it's not only my feet, but thousands and tens of thousands of feet from other people who love Jesus that have prayed for me, that have given to me, and may even come out here themselves one day so that you could hear about Jesus." How important is a missionary? So important is the difference between heaven and hell. Therefore, how important is your praying? How important is your giving? How important is your going? It's the difference between heaven and hell. And together, we can do more for Jesus. I pray that you would give. I pray that you would pray. I pray that you would ask God, God, would you want me to be a missionary? He calls missionaries out of churches just like this. Now let's all stand. And I want you to take that offering envelope for the Lottie Moon Christmas offering for international missions. If you didn't come prepared to give today, I want you to take it home. Everybody stand, please. And say, Lord, what do you want me to give? And then bring it back next week. And if the Lord has led you to give weekly, and that's because you have to give like we do sometimes, weekly, W-E-A-K-L-E-Y. Give weekly, weekly, but it all adds up. We want to try to meet our goal by the end of December, $2,500. Bring it back next week with something in it. Or if you're able to leave something in it today, let's get off to a good start. We did that Tuesday night at our Thanksgiving event. We took an offering then. So would you give? Father, as we bow this morning, we thank you that Jesus came and how beautiful his feet were, and yet we pierced him, ran an iron nail through him to what became a bloody cross, as we pierced his hands also and ran a sword through his side, Lord. Platted the thorny crowns on his head after we'd already bruised him and beat him. And yet, Lord, when we look at those feet now, how beautiful they are. Because he came that we might be saved. Father, we want to be a church that's more than just a church in name. We want to be known by our praying, by our giving, by our going. Not necessarily known to the world, but known to you because you know all things. And Father, we pray that you would help us with this Lottie Moon Christmas offering to meet our goal and then to meet the goal of our Southern Baptist Convention of $185 million. Because we know that every penny will go to support a missionary to help them stay on the field so they can stay there face to face with those that they minister to, that will help them, Lord, to have the projects available that they need in building churches and having literature, medical supplies even, all the different ways, even those who are agricultural missionaries and growing crops and then, Lord, tending animals, Lord. Many of these nations need such help. Lord, help us be faithful with the prayer guide, Lord, to look each and every day those missionaries that represent just a small part of the many missionaries we have on the field. But in much the same, Lord, are ministering like they are. And Father, we pray this and we ask this in Jesus' name. And all God's people that are going, that are praying, that are giving, said, Amen. You may be here this morning, you've never given your heart to Jesus Christ. You just don't know how beautiful those feet are. He came that you might be saved. Maybe this morning you're not a member of this church, but God says, this is where you need to come. This is the time that you come to present yourself for salvation in the Lord Jesus Christ or to be a church member here at Victory Baptist Church. Sister Lynn's going to lead us in the song. In times like these, we need a Savior, and there's one, I'm promising you, and he's here waiting on you. I'll meet you down front. As we sing, Sister Lynn, would you lead us?
Like these, you need an anchor. Be very sure. Your anchor holds and grips the solid rock. This rock is Jesus. Yes, he's the
Who need to know that he's Lord and Savior. This is what your mission giving, praying, and going does. I want you to look up here and notice that I'm holding up our new personal study guides for our next series of lessons, and it's going to be in the book of Ezekiel. There's a whole bunch of them out there on the table. And Brother Derek, you and Brother Clint, would you make sure that everyone is offered to take one of these home? Now, this brings up the question about, what about the video lessons? We're still having difficulties on the Sunday school lesson, but I think I'm going to be able to get this one out, this service out today, and hopefully we can continue going each week and stay up to date with that. And when you get the video, and you're looking at me and say, but I've already been here live, do you have somebody in your address book that doesn't come to church? Forward that link to them and say, hey, listen to our preacher. He ain't much to look at, but he says something about Jesus. So would you do that? Share it. And if you're on Facebook, share it on Facebook. Try to get the word out. Have those beautiful feet that the Bible talks about. So pick up your free copy. It begins next week, the December 5th lesson. And these are good, good study guides. After you use them, you can keep them in your library. They are that good. Anything else that we need to share before we dismiss?
I forgot to emphasize that what they bake, they bring on the 19th for the sale.
Yeah, you'll bring the baked goods on the 19th, but you need to tell her what you're baking so she can make the list up that we can write down and bid for, okay?
And also, please pray for my dad who fractured his back when he fell last week, and he's really struggling.
Brother Dewey Reed and Sister Betty, this is Mama.
93.
They're 93, and Lynn and them has got great-grandchildren of their own, and they're trying to minister. They call it the sandwich generation. We're living longer now that we're going past the third generation, the fourth generation, and we're having to take care of our parents as well as take care of our children and their children. And it puts that generation, you're just being pulled both ways. It used to be we thought we'd get our age and we could retire. But not anymore. You're working more now than you did when you wish you had a job you could go off to and not be distracted by all that. You're not being distracted. You're trying to help your mom. But this is the times we live in. So please pray for our elderly and those who take care of them. Any other prayer requests? Don't forget Brother Clint's friend and their family. Brother Alex, do you mind closing us out in prayer? Let's pray.
Heavenly Father, as we come to you this afternoon, we we'll say thank you for bringing us all together.
Yes, Lord.
God, thank you for allowing us to make it to another Thanksgiving.
Yes.
God, it's a lot to be thankful for. It's not just the meal, but just to be thankful to gather together as one during this COVID-19, they call it. But God, do not allow COVID-19 to distract us and bring us together.
Yes.
Pastors, that we're living in a day and time that we do need to draw closer to you than ever before. And we thank you for bringing us together. We thank you as we depart in different ways, as we turn left and right onto 92, protect each one of us in here. Guide us, protect our families, shield us, and thank you again for this great service tonight. And if we forgot things, just pray for the blessing in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Thank you, Brother Alex. God bless you.
Well, the Lord says, and he does it over. You're not a fair weather fan then, are you?
No.
Haven't been too much fair weather for us lately, eh?
Yep.
We went to the game yesterday.
Yes, yes, that's what you said.
It was, oh yeah, I told you. Get the tall man to do things.
Here, Sandra.
Huh?
My sister's a
paperback. Yeah, I know. That's why
Brother Red was like upset when he saw the license plate. Oh!
I see this nice car coming in, and I can't believe.
We gotta rag him. We gotta double up on him. Give him a hard time.
Yeah.
Should we got to make those things, you know, we put up the locks.